example, we're so thankful to have you with us. And for those who are not members of the body of Christ, you are our very important guest. We're just delighted to have you with us during this revival effort. And we pray that you will come back out and take the opportunity to learn what thus saith the Lord. Amen. Brother Boss has done a wonderful job.
Amen.
The purpose of this has been to revive. Why is there a need to revive? Well, sometimes things get sick. Amen. People get sick.
Mm-hmm.
They don't do as well as they could or should be doing. And we have to take time to nurture and feed them and bring them back to where they need to be, because we're trying to get to heaven. And here's the reality that I want to show with you. Reality versus perception. Perception says everybody going to heaven.
That's right.
Yeah. I talked to Jesus about that.
Yeah.
That ain't what Jesus said.
Right.
My Bible says,
not everyone.
In Matthew chapter 7, verse 21,
not everyone that said
unto me, Lord, shall enter
into the kingdom,
of heaven.
But he that doeth the will,
or she, that doeth the will of my Father. It's going to take some doing on our behalf.
Amen.
God has given the gift, but if you're not willing to go and get the gift, amen. The gift does you no benefit. He says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied thy name? In thy name, thou cast out devil, in thy name, done many wonderful works. And then what I confess, this is Jesus, not Brother Bishop, because say what Jesus said, amen. Mm-hmm. And then what I confess unto them, I never knew you. Mm-hmm. Three words. Mm-hmm. You don't want to hear. That's four. I never knew you. Four words, amen. I don't hear those four words. And the thing about it, I don't want anybody to hear it until I hear those words. But I can't do it for you. At some point, somewhere along the way, something is going to have to connect. And say, this thing is reality.
Mm-hmm.
Not the way we perceive it, not the way we want it to be. Everybody's going to heaven. And that's what the world is preaching, right?
Mm-hmm.
Not so. Jesus said so. He's qualified to say so. He has the authority to say so. And I choose to believe Jesus. I'm going to do what God says to me. I'm going to do His will. Amen. Wherever that may take me, I'm going to do His will. Whoever I have to leave behind in the process of doing His will, somebody can say amen.
Amen.
Jesus says, if you count them mother, father, amen. I'm not going to treat them as I forgot. Our speaker for tonight, Brother Cone Price, from the Quincy Road Church of Christ, out of Memphis, Tennessee. Love him like a brother in Christ and outside of Christ. That's biological. We're just delighted to have him with us. We've had a wonderful time. And we pray that you will sit back and listen and absorb, amen, God's word as he presents it. We're trying to get to heaven. Number 905 in the song books. Next question we have about the Combs Rogers. From the Quincy Road Church of Christ out of Memphis, Tennessee. Verse 2 of 905.
Yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. Of
that God has allowed us another opportunity to come and to worship and adore His wonderful name. I am thankful for the invitation to come and be with you these few days as we listen and absorb the Word of God. It is always a joy to come and to sit and listen to God as He talks to us. I've seen in my years of preaching that we always want God to listen to us. But tonight is one of those occasions when God needs you to listen to Him. And so we encourage you to listen to Him and absorb what He has to say to you and for you. I've learned also that the Bible is going to hit all of us. And so we have to learn how to appreciate what God has said to us and for us. Another thing I've learned about the Bible is that the Bible is a book about love. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now some might say, well, that's all we talk about is love. I don't think we talk about the love of God enough. We need to realize that love, because you talk about love, it doesn't mean that you ought to take advantage of another person's love. When someone loves you, it reciprocates. It makes you understand that I can invest in that individual when I know they love me. Amen, somebody. When husbands and wives are in love with each other, she doesn't mind getting up, cooking breakfast early in the morning. He doesn't need to give her a rule book, say, cook my breakfast at 8 o'clock and have my lunch at 12. She'll do it because she loves him. And he'll bring the check home, amen, somebody. He'll make sure the bread is on the table because he loves her. And so God loves us, and we ought to really appreciate what God has done for all of us. Sometimes I learned in the church that sometimes we are just hard. We want God to be this hard person coming down on us all the time. God is not trying to come down on you hard. If God wanted to come down on you hard, He can do it. Did you know that He can come down on your heart if He wants to? God is not trying to destroy you. God wants to save you. And many times we feel as if God is this person with this big old whip and ball and chain trying to beat up on us and tell us what to do. But can I tell you something? If God didn't love you, if God didn't care for you, you wouldn't be sitting here right now.
Amen.
So you ought to learn to appreciate that I'm going to absorb all that God has in store for me. I'm not going to let anybody stop me from understanding what God is doing for me. It is good, again, to see all of you here tonight, and on this last night of this revival meeting, I want to try my best. And a couple of sermons I threw around in my head. I threw around the birds in the tree, and I said, no, I ain't going to preach that. Amen. Because some of y'all like birds in the trees. Amen. There's some birds in the church. You got some peacocks in the church. Amen, somebody. Just want to show their feathers. That's all they want to do. You got some sparrows in the church. They want to jump from limb to limb. They're not stable, not consistent in anything. And I said, no, I ain't going to preach that. Then I thought about the 23rd Psalm. I thought about how David talked about how he was cast down. And the word cast down means that a sheep was turned over, bent up, and all of his circulation was out of his leg, and he could not get up. And I wanted to talk about that. I wanted to talk about cast down, but not counted out, because a lot of times we go through things in life, and we are cast down, and we need somebody to come along and lift us up and rub our legs so that the circulation can start again, and we can live our lives faithful in Christ Jesus. And I want all of us to have a compassionate heart to know that there are people hurting in the church, and if we can't have a compassionate heart to help those people get back up on their feet, God is going to hold us responsible. And we have got to learn not to be stumbling blocks, not amen, but learn to let people take their stumbling blocks and use them as stepping stones to greater things in life. So I don't want God to tell me, you are the one standing in the way of somebody trying to get to me. I want to tell you about the I just don't read the Bible just for words. I read it for contextual sake. I read it to give, to understand, so that I can exegetically bring out what a passage says. And all of us ought to really understand, the Bible is not here to try to make us feel bad. The Bible is here to give us comfort and to give us security, knowing that God has something for you and He wants to give it to you. He's not trying to hold back from nobody. He wants to give you everything He promised you. Now, I finally settled in. I found Saturday on Matthew chapter 16 and verses number 26. I want to look at this for just a few minutes tonight, and then I'm going to let you go home. I know it is a Wednesday night. I know you still have to go to work in the morning and all of those things. But I want to try our best tonight to try to give you something to help you in your life. You may get mad at me, but I'm going to tell you, if you listen to God, it'll bless your life. It'll bless you to be a better person. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 16 in verses number 26. The Bible says, "For what is a man profit if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" Notice that question. He says, "Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" In the morning Bible classes, these last Monday and Tuesday, I was talking about how the soul is what God wants to save. There's a flesh side of you, and there is a spiritual side of you. The spirit wants to feed your soul. The flesh wants to take you away from God. We all have flesh issues, and our spirit is trying to feed us to make us closer to God. Well, I wish I had time to do that a little bit more. But notice what Jesus says. Or notice what you're saying is here in verse 21. The disciples, the Bible says, "For the time for began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go into Jerusalem, that suffer many things of the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day." Jesus was headed towards Jerusalem to be crucified. Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, "Be it far from thee, Lord. This shall not be unto thee." In other words, Peter said, "Lord, I ain't going to let that happen to you." Oh, and Jesus turned and said to him, "Peter," he said, "get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me. Thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men." Peter wanted Jesus to stay because Peter was getting everything he needed as long as Jesus was right by his side. And can't we be selfish sometimes? God is not just for Peter. He's for folk right now, right here in Fortunate, Arkansas. God is not just back there in the Bible. He's right here with us now. And we have to learn how to appreciate knowing that God just didn't stay there with Peter and the apostle. God went to the cross, or Jesus went to the cross for all mankind. Peter, he said, "Peter, you're acting like the devil. Get behind me." Then said Jesus unto the disciple, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself." And that's a powerful statement. We have to learn how to forget about who you are and start recognizing who God is and what he's done for you, and take up his cross and follow me. I wish I had time to do all of that. And then whosoever will save his life, notice this, shall lose it. He said, "Whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it." He says again, for what is a man profit if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Mm-hmm. Or what shall he give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in his glory of his Father with his holy angels, and then shall he reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there will be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the kingdom come with power, or coming in his kingdom. That God is trying to show all of us that there's something that
people, they just go completely out of it. The loss of your soul is greater than anything else in this world. And Jesus says again, you read it again, read it closely. Listen to the passage. Get a clear understanding of this passage. screen. We have all the luxury of life. We have the TVs in every room. We're enjoying life. When you move into your new home, it's better. You have, hey man, like I told you before, you got better neighbors. You have a better address up there. You have a better house. It's called a mansion. You have better streets. No pothole. And hey man, the streets are paved with gold. You have a city. No robbing, no stealing, no killing. You ain't got the water being terminated. The water
given us everything we need in order for us to be saved. Now, why do we make excuses
as to why we can't serve the Lord?
With gladness. Mm-hmm. Why can't we serve Him with gladness? We always want to put somebody else in the way of our gladness and make an excuse as to why we can't praise God. I told you the other day, to the end, if Brother Bishop is your problem, you're looking at the wrong thing. If Brother Bishop is your problem, if Brother Leon's your problem, you're looking at the wrong thing. See, what you got to do is you got to learn how to move them out of the way. You follow what I'm saying? Y'all make sense. I wish I could show you about the sheep that's cast down. See, when a sheep is cast down, see, a sheep needs help. You follow what I'm saying? And I don't know if y'all realize it or not, when you go through your stuff and you get tired of going to church, song don't mean nothing no more to you. Come on, y'all, help me out here, man. Because sometimes you go to church, that song don't mean nothing to you. You hear the word of God being read, don't mean nothing to you no more. In order for you to get back to there, you got to realize you lost something. You lost something. When the word don't mean nothing to you no more, you lost something. Mm-hmm. And when you get back to the point of understanding His word is a lamp unto my feet and a light to my path, then I can look to the hills for what's coming to my help. Then I can start understanding my help comes from the Lord. It don't come from Brother Bishop. It don't come from me. It comes from the Lord. That's why David did say the Lord is my shepherd. Get back to good shepherd. All of us need good shepherd. Look, I get tired sometimes. Get frustrated sometimes. I feel like giving up sometimes. I feel like I can't go any further sometimes. But then the Holy Spirit just kind of revived my soul again. And then I started keep on moving, and I find out that the stuff I went through, it was only a test so that I could have a testimony.
Yeah.
So whatever you're going through right now, it's only a test so you can have a testimony. So whatever you're struggling with right now, you keep pushing. You keep going. Because on the other side of that test is a testimony for you. And you stop being scared, stop being afraid of your testimony, because God saved you through that so that you can help somebody else. You get all embarrassed and ashamed about the stuff we've been through in life. God put you through that stuff so that you can come back and help somebody else that's struggling with. And we try to hide our problem. We've been having a drinking problem, gambling problem, a cheap problem, whatever problem you got, and you want to hide it. You don't want nobody to know. And true enough, you don't want anybody to know your business. Amen. But God sent you through stuff so that you can be a help to somebody else.
Amen.
Don't keep it to yourself, because it's not to you. It's for all of us. We are workers together with God. And so when God puts you through something, start recognizing it's there to help somebody else with. I don't know about you, but let me tell you, the stuff that I've been through in life, I used to think folk were trying to get me and bother me. But you know what? Every time they did something bad to me, I knew it was just a stepping stone to help me get to somewhere better. Remember Joseph? Remember Joseph? They threw him in the pit. They came along, and soldiers came along, and they sold him in. What did they eat? Y'all know the story, don't you? To make a long story short, sure. You know, Joseph became second in command over all the Potiphar's house. What were they trying to do? They were trying to kill him. But what they didn't know is that they were putting him in a pit, but God was getting ready to set him on the pinnacle.
Amen.
So you have to learn that lesson as well. Your struggle is there to help you understand. You got to go through the pit and I'll get set up on the pinnacle.
Amen.
So if you're here tonight, and you're struggling, and you're weak, and you don't know which way to go, I'm trying to tell you now. If you lost, it ain't God's fault. If you get out here and get hung up in the world, it ain't God's fault. God has given you everything you need right here, even tonight, for you to get yourself together. And if I were you, I wouldn't leave it. I'd know that I stand a distance from God. Because who knows where death is? Who knows when your number is going to come up? And if God called you tonight, and I'm not trying to scare you, I'm just trying to have a way, make you aware that nothing you have belongs to you. Even you don't belong to you. Because when God get ready to come for you, you got to get out of here. And can't nobody stop you. And so I'm trying to tell you tonight, don't let this be a moment to where you just come and you just talk about the good sermon, the bad sermon, whatever you're going to have in your mind and all of that. Let it be an opportunity where you say, it's time for me to get my life right with God. Yes, sir. And I'm going to make every effort I can. Yes, sir. And I know people are going to talk about it. I know they're going to call me out of my name. They're going to think this. They're going to think that. But you got to work towards being like God for yourself.
Yes, sir.
So tonight, I challenge you. What's standing in front of you? What's hindering you tonight? What's holding you up? God says, I got it all ready for you. Salvation is here for you tonight. If I'm lost, it's not God's fault. It's all mine. What shall it profit me if he gained the whole world? You own all the whole, you own all the world, and you lose your soul. Or what can you give in exchange for? Sometimes we think we can switch stuff out to bribe God. God is not, can't be bribed by your ways and your thoughts. God is not compromising for you in the sense that he is not going to trade you. God wants to save you just the way you are. And so sometimes, and what I'm trying to tell you is this, sometimes we try to wait until we get everything together. You'll be waiting to this time next year and even longer if you're trying to get yourself together. Because it's not going to happen. What you, why do you think you're out there now? Why do you think you're out there now? Why do you think you're struggling now? It's because you have tried to do it on your own. And you can't do it by yourself. Jesus says, through the Hebrew writer, I will never leave you, nor will I forsake you. And if you're here tonight and you're not a Christian, you do so by faith, repentance, confession, and baptism in Christ. That's God's plan to save all men. And I think that's pretty easy to understand. And I'm not going to change that. You can't change that. That's just God's way of saving you. We have to embrace that. And if you're out there, you or you're a member of the church, if you're out there and you've lost your faith in God, I'm asking you again. I'm asking you to look at you. If I'm lost, whose fault will it be? In either case tonight, we're asking you to come. Right now, let's together.
Here are some things.